Hello, I'm Lee Burnick, Dean of the Greenspan College of Urban Affairs, and I want to welcome you to another edition of the Urban Report. Today's show will focus on a remarkable woman who passed away June 1st, Barbara Greenspan. Barbara was born in London, raised in Ireland, and met and married Hank Greenspan during World War II. Shortly thereafter, they went back to the States, or moved to the States, and then in the late 40s moved to Las Vegas. And a city which she came to embrace and love. Barbara's causes were many, and her accomplishments were many, but I think the two most important ones for her, as I understand it, were the Las Vegas Sun, and most importantly, her family. And we are fortunate today to have one of the four children, Janie Greenspan Gale. And we want to welcome you here to the show.
Thanks, Lee.
And I want to talk to you about the family. And at the funeral, I found it to be a very emotional funeral, and one that was remarkable because the children, but also the grandchildren, had these very strong ties to Barbara, as I guess she liked to be called by everyone. And I want to just talk about start out with the conversation when you talked about your mother. You talked about how you were your father's daughter, but in the end you said you were very much your mother's daughter. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, I think it's pretty normal that daughters have that special relationship with their father where they can do no wrong. I was the apple of my father's eye. I sang, I danced, I wanted to be an actress. My mother always accused my father of being a frustrated actor, you know, so we sort of had this kinship, you know, whereas my mother was the proper one, the strict one. Everything has rules. I didn't follow rules. I wandered around. I, you know, lived sort of in my own head playing with paper dolls and dolls. But the more I got to know my mother, the older I got and stopped fighting with my mother, the more I realized I was like my mother.
And what would you say were the things that you were like your mother?
Her love of the family, her sense of doing good work without recognition, without fanfare, her enormous loyalty and fierceness as far as her husband and her children. I understand my mother now. I didn't always understand my mother. I thought she was just, you know, this Victorian raised, proper, you know. But she had such a funny side. She was so funny. And I think, you know, all of us have parts of both our parents.
Right.
I think the thread running through my family that we have from my mother and father is the humor. I think we all, when we get together, it's, you know, there's a lot of laughing and punching and crying that go on, but mostly laughing.
What were the dinner tables like? What was dinner time?
My parents didn't eat with us because, you know, we were noisy, we were rowdy, we were obstreperous, you know, we were, you know, the fighting kids all the time. My parents would go out every night dancing. And they used to go to the skylight room at the Desert Inn and dress beautifully every night. They'd go out, and as soon as they'd leave the house, the four of us would, you know, rumble in the living room. So,
yeah.
Until something broke, you know, then we'd have to stop.
Okay. Well,
so dinner time was again noisy.
Brian
was the meat and potatoes guy. I just liked the green stuff on the plates, you know.
Even back then, just the green stuff.
Yeah, but fighting, yeah. Always fighting, arguing.
Okay.
Throwing things, you know.
Was she the disciplinarian of the two?
They both were. They both were disciplinarians. My father started off as the disciplinarian with Susan, but never really, really, you know, touched me or, you know, spanked me or yelled at me or anything. I think once.
Okay.
Once I can remember over oatmeal. But
over oatmeal.
Over oatmeal. I wouldn't eat it. But,
no.
You know, other than that, I don't remember him ever, like, yelling at me. And believe me, he could have. But, my mother was the one that set the rules. She set the rules.
Well, we have a clip. Let's look at this clip. This is your mother talking about your father and the family. Can we roll that film?
Tough as he was very soft and gentle. He was so devoted to his children. but he would take the bottles at night or diaper them when they cried. But as they grew up, he would take them to school. He would feed them breakfast. I haven't met many men like that to this day. Very romantic. Our favorite song was Where or When.
It seems we stood and talked like this before. We looked at each other in the same way, but I can't remember where.
And we went dancing just about every night. Oh, my feet never touched the ground. And we used to go dancing there at the Desert Inn Sky Room.
Yeah.
Great pictures.
Great pictures.
Great little story, part of the documentary about the family. In there, let's talk about, you know, there are pictures of them with Sinatra and other, you know. At what point did you realize, or how did that work, that you were not, that Barbara wasn't just your mother? I mean, was there a sense that Barbara, did you ever have that sense that she was this, she iconic or?
No. She was always just my mother. I mean, I knew that she was loved, and because everywhere I went, it didn't matter if I was at the Sahara Hotel or wherever I was, the waitress, the bellman, somebody would come up and tell me how great my mother was. But my father too, you know, but still they were our parents.
Parents.
And our parents, and the extraordinary things that they did every single day of their lives was just what we were expected to do. We were supposed to get up every single day of our lives and do something good. You know, that's just how we were raised.
And that doing something good, okay, that was through their actions. Did they communicate that, or did they communicate through actions rather than words, do you think?
I would say through actions and words. I mean, it's our heritage. It's what we're supposed to do.
Right.
You know, you give back.
Right.
And give back. I mean, I never, ever, ever knew we had money.
Never knew.
Because when kids at school would tease me about being Little Miss Rich so-and-so, you know, I'd come home, I'd say, Mommy, are we rich? And she'd say, no, we don't have any money. And I'd say, oh, okay. You know, and I didn't know what they were talking about.
You didn't know?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
But as children, we didn't have money. We lived in a little tiny house. My father ran a newspaper. We never had any money. It wasn't until, you know, later on, you know, with the real estate and all, and the cable companies and all of that kind of stuff. I mean, later, much, much later, when we were all grown up. So, yeah, we were raised a very simple, happy life here in Las Vegas.
Raised, not necessarily with money, but it wasn't simple. I mean, you know, it was...
It was simple for us. It was normal to have, you know, a United States Senator in your living room. It was normal to have Hopalong Cassidy in your living room when you came home. You know, it was great fun.
Well, I thought that was...
Well, it was just what my father did. He had all these important, wonderful friends.
Okay.
You know.
So
he was always on the phone with an Israeli president or a, you know, ambassador from somewhere. You know, it's just who he talked to. It's what he did.
And did, you know, did your mother ever, your father had a whole bunch of causes and there was the McCarthy era and McCarran and Watergate. And did she ever say, what are we getting into again? Or, I mean, what was...
No, I told the story. We were in the car going somewhere one night to dinner, my parents and I. And I was sitting in the back seat, and they were arguing. I couldn't tell you what it was about. But again, he was about to do something. And my mother said, out of frustration, they were arguing about, you can't do this. You have to stop. You know, we just finished something. Let's just be calm, you know. And he said, no, I've got to do this. And she finally said, why can't you just be boring for once? You know, so no, he was never boring.
Never
ever.
Boring.
Never boring. Not once.
And she never got frustrated. I mean, besides saying that, I mean.
She didn't like to be bored.
She didn't like to be bored either.
She was always busy too.
Okay.
She was always busy too.
Part of that busy, and besides in terms of raising the family, you went back to her home, to Ireland, and on many occasions, right? Is that?
Well, we did travel to Ireland in the late 60s, 68, to go on this very calm, wonderful trip. My sister and her granddaughter went to visit my mother's home in Dublin, in Rathmines. I've seen pictures of it. I've heard stories about her childhood in Dublin. But I didn't actually go visit the home. But the trip we took to Ireland was really one of the seminal experiences of my life.
In a positive way?
No. It was hilarious. The positive thing was it's probably one of the funniest things that my family had ever embarked on. But
is that right? And yeah. Your mother bore up under all the chaos?
No. She maintained her dignity and her composure, even though she wanted to slap all of us, I'm sure. But she was the one. We had to drive around this big, ridiculous Austin Princess car. And we'd get in every morning, and my mother would say, just a minute. She'd lift the center glass thing up, and she'd sit back and she'd go, okay. And then we all say, we'd all have to sit quietly till the glass was raised. Nobody could hear us, screaming at each other.
Okay.
So that's sort of what my mother did. She made us behave in public.
But at home it was chaos.
Yeah.
And she was able to deal with that.
But just how, there were ways you behaved in public, and that was that, you didn't create scenes, and you didn't carry on in public.
In public.
Yes.
Okay. I
never got that one.
Okay.
I
know that.
We've all been given to scenes in public.
Yes. Well, I know that you and I talked one time about your experiences in 1968, and your father went out to Chicago. Mm-hmm. What was her response to all that? When you were at the Chicago Democratic Convention and the marches, and do you have a sense?
I don't remember what my mother's said. Because what happened when I came home was really when my mother got involved, and that was in the airport. After that whole radicalization of Jane in Chicago, 1968. My father and I were protesting and chased and tear gassed, and we went basically as newspaper people, and I wanted to be a peace delegate, but it turned out badly. Anyway, when I got home, when we met an attorney for Nixon in the airport in Los Angeles, and I was so angry, and my father was just telling him that we had just done this, this thing in Chicago and with the country, and he was so upset, and he said, well, do you want to do something constructive? And I said, sure. What? Actually, I didn't. I wanted to blow up the Pentagon. But I said, what are my options here? And he said that Nixon was running for president, and one of the things he wanted to do was give 18-year-olds a right to vote, but he needed a test case, and when I would do that. So I said, sure, what do I have to do? And he said, just register to vote in the state of Nevada, and when they turn you down, then, we can start this case. So that's sort of what happened. And that's, my mother got very much behind that. She was all for that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So she was pushing you to...
Not pushing me, but
not
supporting.
Not pushing,
it.
Supporting. Supporting is the better
supporting,
word.
Yeah.
And she was supportive of the four of you throughout.
Whatever we did.
Whatever she did.
Whatever we did. And you only knew... she let you know when you were doing something she didn't approve of.
Okay.
It took a long time to get...
To that
the
point.
Approval.
Oh, to get the approval.
To get the approval. You had to do pretty, pretty good. She didn't give out compliments lightly.
But she did give them out.
She did.
She did give them out.
She did.
And you all seem to have, again, based on the funeral and just knowing all of you, she did a very good job.
Well, thank you.
Right?
Thank
of
you
raising
very much.
The four.
That would make her about the happiest. Her children are good.
Yeah.
Because I don't think she held out much hope for a long time.
Okay. Well, we want to stop here, and we have another guest, someone from the paper, and we want to talk a little bit about the paper. I want to thank you.
Well, thank you, Lee. It was a pleasure.
I enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Hello again. Welcome back to the Urban Report in our special edition on Barbara Greenspun. We now have two people who know Barbara from another role, and that is her role in the publishing business and as the owner of the Las Vegas Sun. Our one guest is the Chief Operating Officer for Greenspun Media Corporation, Brian Allison. And we welcome you here to the show. You knew Barbara and you were with the Sun. Mm-hmm. Came to the Sun in the early 90s, and you're back with the Greenspun Media Group now, and we welcome you. Our other guest is Mary Hausch. Mary is a faculty member of the university and of Hank Greenspun School of Journalism and Media Studies, and a longtime resident of Las Vegas, and worked for the RJ, and may have some stories about the relationship between the RJ and the Sun, but just knew Barbara anyway in her role as a newswoman. Let's talk about Hank Greenspun. It was seen as the editor, the owner, and everything, but what was the role that Barbara played? I don't know, Mary, you may know about that in the earlier years. Brian came in the 90s after Hank passed away. But what role did Barbara play early on in the development of the paper? Do you have any?
She didn't have a real visible role, but Hank had, I think, liked and admired strong women, which Barbara was. And his right-hand person was a woman named Ruthie Deskin. And I think Barbara and Ruthie together were very influential on Hank and decisions that he made.
And after Hank passed away, she became the publisher of the newspaper. Mm-hmm. And what was her presence at the, I mean, here she is, a very visible within the community and doing all kinds of philanthropic activities. What was her presence at the paper like?
She, you know, when I came to work at the Sun, I remember seeing Barbara at work every day. And she would, you know, walk through the newsroom. She'd talk to different people. You know, she didn't play a heavy-handed role. Mike O'Callaghan probably played more of that role in those days, where he would come out and just provide so much insight and depth about the community. And that's one of the neat things about working at the Sun. Over the years, I've seen people who've come to join the organization. They don't know a lot about maybe the Greenspuns at first. They might know about their philanthropy. They might know about buildings and sections of town named after them, but they maybe don't know the full story. And as they started to read about the family, as they started to understand that history, they'd realize they were working with someone who was part of that history. And you just don't see that very often in your career. And it just made for a very meaningful and special kind of relationship. And, you know, in the later years when Barbara wasn't able to come to work as often, she still would make it to holiday parties or make appearances. And it was just very heartfelt, the reaction that the employees would have to seeing her there, because she was so emblematic of what the Sun stood for. And it was very neat.
And I know you have a couple stories, but the Sun and what it stood for, to what degree, you know, we had Janie talking about how the causes and doing the right thing. Was that clear to everybody when at the Sun that the paper stood for doing the right thing? I mean, how did that come across? I mean, is that part of what Barbara's legacy?
Absolutely, it was part of what Barbara and Hank, you know, they ingrained in the family, in their children, and I can tell you, it's a very big part of what we are today. And you know, I tell people again, I've been there for a long time. I worked at the Sun, and then I worked for Vegas.com for a number of years. And I've been in business meetings where we could make a decision to go this way or we could make a decision to go that way. And they're both fine, but the family would always ask, which is the right decision? And not which is going to make us the most money, which is the best for us, which is the right decision for our partners, for the community, and for our business. So it's not just words, it's actions.
Okay. Mary, do you have any insight into that?
I was thinking when you said that, I moved here in 1971, and it was a heyday period for Hank. He had his Where I Stand column on the front page of the paper, and they took a real leadership role, much more so than the RJ, in issues in the community. Hank was among the first to come out against nuclear waste storage, and just vehemently. So front page column after front page column, they ran this little logo of a nuclear bomb, which was deceptive because it was showing, you know, an above ground bomb, but that was to be against nuclear storage. And he was passionate about it and felt it was wrong for our community, wrong for our state, and would say so.
And how was Barbara, did Barbara write columns? Do you remember Barbara ever writing any columns?
She didn't write, but she was, like Brian said, she had a presence there, though, and she was, you know, forceful. I think some people knew they could get to Hank by talking to Barbara, and later after he died, she had a much more active role. She was a real presence at the Sun. And then part of her legacy was the Barbara Greenspun lecture series, and she had strong ideas about the kind of people that she should have come to that.
Okay, good. Her legacy and the ties to the Sun. The Sun is just one part of the media group. Now, what was her sense of how things were changing, or did she have that sense of how news reporting was changing? And
I think she did. You know, I think she that was one where she was passing the torch kind of to the next generation. You know, I remember early on when I first worked at the Sun, and then we started Vegas.com and LasVegasSun.com and all the different websites. And at first, it was just a few of us in a room. Then there were more of us, kind of under the radar for a long time. But we were right next to the Sun's conference room, and everybody and anybody would come to visit the Sun. You'd see, you know, former presidents, you'd see politicians, business leaders. And they would often meet with the editorial board, and Barbara would attend those meetings. And one day she stopped and kind of looked into our room. And, you know, we had some pretty interesting looking characters, you know, as internet people. And saying that in a newsroom, that's going. I mean, newsrooms are already pretty interesting places. She's kind of peered at us and said, you know, who are all you people and what are you doing down here? We said, well, we're building websites. And we tried to show her some. And she was like, okay. Is my son Danny involved with this? We said, yes, he's very actively involved. She's like, okay, I'm fine then. And that was good enough for Barbara. As long as Danny knows what you people are up to,
okay.
I'm okay with it.
All right.
So, but it was, and after she left, a lot of people were like, who was that? Barbara Greenspun.
So she understood and realized that the news was
there
changing.
Was a transition.
There was
exactly.
A transition, and she was okay with that.
Yes.
If the family agreed.
Yes,
that,
she right? was okay with that.
You think what would have happened if you had said no, Danny doesn't know anything about it?
I don't want to think what would have happened. I think we would have been called up to her office.
Yeah. You would have been there without Danny, though. Danny was a real visionary.
He absolutely.
In terms of where the news media was going, he's the first person I heard say that newspapers would disappear.
Yes, Danny reserved LVSun.com in 1989. It was one of the first 1,000 domain names that were registered on the internet. Very visionary person, and we still argue about that because I believe that there is a future for print, but. Danny, I mean, as soon as he got the iPad the first day, and he said, now it's really dead.
Well, I'm not sure that it would be dead. I don't think that the family or Barbara, I mean, I can't imagine not having.
It's a changing role, and right. I see parts of print, you know, this isn't necessarily a discussion, but I see print changing, and the iPad is definitely going to change things. The internet has changed things. There's lots of different ways that people want to consume media. And print, I think, remains one of them.
Okay. Now, you said Barbara. Let's go back. Barbara came into the office. She had an office in all three. There were three different buildings that they were in, right?
Yes.
And so she had an office in each of those. What was her role early on in the paper? Mary, do you have an idea? I mean, you talked about Ruthie and how they would work with Hank, but I've heard stories that she was the bill collector, do you have any idea?
I don't know about that personality, firsthand knowledge of it, but I always knew that Barbara and Ruthie, people talked about them in one sentence, and their influence on Hank.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And even in those, when I was working at the Sun, there was a place, a restaurant down the street from the Sun when it was located on Valley View. Many old-time people remember the original Sonia's chicken restaurant and chicken rotisserie restaurant, and Ruthie and Barbara went to lunch there almost every day. And again, Ruthie did write for the paper, and I think, again, a lot of those, a lot of the philanthropic activities and a lot of the influence of the paper in those areas were direct results of Barbara's influence.
And, you know, that's an example of how down home she was. Yeah. When you mentioned Sonia's, Sonia's is a, I would say, very middle class kind of chicken restaurant. And Barbara would eat in there. And in fact, I recall going in there one day with somebody and seeing Barbara and Ruthie and thinking, what are they doing in this neighborhood little humble restaurant
that you
would have thought they would have been over at the DI Country Club having lunch?
No, they would go there all the time.
And Barbara, she raised her family in the neighborhood I live in now, which is a, you know, very average sort of neighborhood. And that was her origins.
Okay. Well, we need to wrap this up. And I do want to thank you in giving us some insight of Barbara in a different vein from the family one, the publisher of the Las Vegas Sun. And again, thank you for both of you for coming in and giving us some insight. We appreciate it. And thank you for watching the Urban Report. We appreciate you watching. And if you have any comments, please write email lee.burnick@unlv.edu. Thank you very much.